Hello everyone. With the appropriate choice of imaging sequence parameters, TE, TR and TI, we have shown how spin-spin and longitudinal relaxation provide us with unique contrast mechanisms that allow us to control the relative signal intensities to some extent and to optimize the image contrast between tissues. There are a number of advanced MRI methods that utilize other contrast mechanisms. One of the most important is diffusion-weighted imaging. In water, the molecules are free to move in random directions and undergo so-called Brownian motion. The translation of water molecules over large distances is known as diffusion. In biological tissue, water diffusion rates are dependent on the viscosity and temperature, and diffusion may be restricted by interaction with cell membranes, proteins, and other structures. In tissues with collinear structures such as muscle, fibers, or neurons in the brain, the water molecules may have a preferred direction of diffusion. As we will see in a moment, a magnetic field gradient will exaggerate the effect of diffusion on the MR signal of water molecules. So what is the effect of diffusion on the MR signal in imaging? Here we consider transverse magnetization during a spin echo sequence. Firstly, for stationary spins that are not diffusing. The spin vector in the rotating frame initially does not precess, but when a field gradient is applied, it will precess at a frequency given by the new value of the field at that point. The 180 degree pulse then rotates the vector around the axis of the pulse, and if an identical gradient is applied again, then the vector will precess through the same angle and align along the axis where it began, forming a spin echo. This echo forms because the precession imposed by the gradient is identical before and after the 180 degree pulse. What happens then to spins that are moving? On the left we see the stationary spins again for comparison. For the diffusing spins, we see that as the spin moves through the field gradient, its rate of precession changes accordingly, and following the 180 degree pulse, the spin may not have experienced the same field strength as before the pulse. Therefore, the spin vector will not be aligned along the same axis as before. For a collection of spins, this results in a reduction in intensity of the spin echo, since all spins do not refocus. So the image intensity becomes weighted by the diffusion. The rate of diffusion is defined by a rate constant, known as the apparent diffusion constant, and this ADC is a property of the particular tissue. Faster diffusion will result in loss of signal, whereas restricted diffusion, which reduces the ADC, will result in higher signal. So diffusion-weighted imaging can help detect regions of abnormal tissue, where the tissue structure is damaged and therefore the water diffusion is altered. This is important for the detection of stroke and cancer, where the cellular integrity is lost, water is taken into the cells, and so diffusion is significantly restricted, resulting in an increase in signal compared to healthy tissue. Often the relaxation characteristics of the tissue do not change, and so the effect of the damage may not be detected in T1 or T2 weighted images. Here is a standard T2 weighted image of a stroke victim, and it is difficult to identify any regions of damage to the brain tissue. However, if a diffusion-weighted image is acquired, then the region of the brain damaged by the infarct shows a large increase in signal due to restricted diffusion of water in that tissue, and now the full extent of the tissue damage can be measured. In diffusion, the water molecules may be restricted to moving predominantly in a particular direction, perhaps along muscle fibers or neurons. We can measure the predominance of water diffusion in a particular direction and therefore determine the direction of the fibers. In this image, the predominant diffusion direction is indicated by a different color depending on whether the direction of the motion is side to side, top to bottom, or in and out of the page. We can further use this information to visualize the fiber bundles and connection between parts of the brain. This is information that is not obtainable by standard imaging methods and has become important in the understanding of brain function and connectivity, and may be an indicator of neuronal integrity in diseases such as Alzheimer's disease and multiple sclerosis. As well as random diffusion, we can also measure the flow of spins or the perfusion of agents introduced into the body, which have an effect on the MR signal. Special contrast agents that change the relaxation properties of water spins, and therefore change the image intensity in the vicinity of the agents, can be introduced by injection into the bloodstream. MRI can observe the wash in and wash out of the bolus of contrast agent delivered. These contrast agents allow detection of the tissue that is highly vascular with enhanced blood flow, such as in tumours. Perfusion imaging is an important diagnostic method for breast cancer, for example. It is also possible to encode moving spins to measure flow, for example in blood. In MR angiography, the signal from moving spins in blood is enhanced by saturating spins in a slab of tissue and observing the stronger signal of unsaturated spins that flow into the slab. A maximum intensity projection of the image then produces a magnetic resonance angiogram. So we have seen how we can enhance image contrast by a variety of methods, by choosing appropriate imaging parameters such as TE and TR, encoding the diffusion of water molecules in tissue to detect changes in tissue structure, using contrast agents to enhance the signal of highly vascular tissue, and also measure flowing spins to visualize the entangled network of blood vessels. All these contrast mechanisms play an important role in providing MRI with the versatility and range of application that make it a key imaging modality for the detection of tissue damage and disease in modern medical diagnosis.